like, you know, they don't know their bicycles, so now they're not familiar with bicycles. Like,
exactly.
It feels like, you know, just leaving the big guy, you know.
Thank you very much.
more of a tech hub. So let me dive into. Before I talk about the Data Science Institute and data science at Columbia, I wanted to kind of frame how I think about data and data science in this bigger, what I call data life cycle. So of course we are, there are many sources of generating data. We generate data everywhere we go. Everything we do on the web, interaction we have both in the digital world and the physical world, we are generating lots and lots of data. And the headlines basically tell this to you, so I don't have to explain it to you. But also a lot of sensors generate data, a lot of the smart building is an example of all the sensors that are here, whether it's cameras and whatnot, that is generating lots and lots of data. Another class of instrument, if you will, that generates data that we often forget about are the very expensive one-off scientific instruments. So I'm thinking here about telescopes, the Large Hadron Collider, all sorts of instruments that the science community uses to generate data either for their experiments or also just what they're viewing in the world, the universe, and so on. So, lots and lots of sources of lots and lots of data. But that's just the first step. Of course, after you generate the data, then you actually are collecting it. And there's often a filtering process between these two steps because you don't always collect everything that's generated. Interestingly, then more is the processing. So after you collect the data, there's usually some manipulation on the data, whether it's compression or encryption, or the usual data cleaning, data wrangling, all that kind of stuff before you actually write the data onto bits. You write the bits into storage, which is the next phase. And now you're actually storing the data in some medium, and it could be anything as a tape or hard drive or more sophisticated optical devices, and so on. The management of data is really to make sure that you're storing the data in such a way so that you can retrieve the data efficiently, so you can manipulate the data, analyze the data efficiently downstream. And then now there's this phase, which I call analysis. This is typically where what people think of data science. They think of machine learning, data mining, all that kind of stuff that you do to the data, that's in the analysis stage. That's typically what people think of when people talk about data science. Of course, I mean the whole thing, so that's why I'm showing you this data life cycle. And then after you use your favorite machine learning algorithm, to spit out some numbers, then you actually want to visualize the result. And you need to present the information in such a way that an end user can look at the result and do something with it. Now normally, things stop there, but since coming to Columbia University, where we have a journalism school, I've learned my lesson that it doesn't stop there. One has to interpret even that visualization, what the journalists like to say, tell a story. Tell a story about this visualization of the data so that the end user can do something with that information. And that's what I mean by interpretation. And later on, I'll give you an example of a beautiful visualization that without the story would be meaningless to you. And then, of course, there's an end user that's going to use this information to maybe to make some decision, make some policy, or make a prediction with the end result of this data life cycle. And then I'm not showing all the loops in between. And throughout this entire life cycle, I like to remind people about the privacy and ethical concerns about the collection and use of data. And again, I think the headlines kind of motivate that. I don't have to spell that out for you today. So I like to give a very succinct definition of data science just to frame us in our thinking of the generality and importance of data science for all of us. And I define data science to be the study of extracting value from data. There are two important words in this definition. One is value. value to a scientist, for instance, could mean gaining new insights, learning some new discovery in science, like looking, discovering some new element in the universe, or finding that, detecting that neutrino, that neutrino ice cube in the South Pole is supposed to be detecting. That value is inherent scientific value. But value, of course, to a corporation that collects data all about us is really about bottom line, user engagement, clicking on ads, clicking on links. That's measurable value. And that is the debate, of course, in this week, if you will, in terms of these companies gaining value on data about us, where we get no value out of it ourselves. That's the debate. But in any case, a value is clearly interpretable by the end user and by the specific domain. And that's why I actually like that word value. So it's not just about discovering knowledge or gaining insights or making predictions and so on. The other word that's important here is attracting, because that's suggestive of it's a lot of work to do this. And then that whole data life cycle is representative of the amount of work for each of the phases that's needed to get that value out. Okay, so now let me talk to you about the mission statement that I set forth for the Data Science Institute at Columbia University. This is something that, just for history, I already told you how we got started 5.5 years ago. With my coming, I have elevated the institute to the university level and university wide. So I really do kind of work with all the other schools on campus, with all the other deans on campus. It's really a university level institute, and as such, I have put forth a pretty broad and ambitious mission statement for the institute to speak to the entire university. So first, I have a three-part mission statement. The first part is advance the state of the art in data science. This really means pushing the frontiers of the field, pushing the frontiers of the field of data science through the basic research that we would do if you are in data science. What's interesting, of course, about this part of the mission statement is data science itself is still a new emerging field. We're still defining it. I recently ran a data science leadership summit, which was we had representatives from UCI there, and it was clear that all of us at our various universities running centers or institutes or initiatives in data science are still figuring out the field, figuring out how to define it, how to deliver it, how to teach it, how to do research, how to promote the field, and so on. So it's really, it's an exciting time to be in this field, because we're defining it. It's great. You don't get to do that very often in your lifetime. At Columbia University, what's unique in terms of the foundations of the field of data science is we draw on computer science, statistics, and operations research. So at Columbia University, we have a very strong industrial and engineering and operations research department in the School of Engineering. And we also have a very strong operations research group in the business school. And they're all colleagues and collaborators. And so I think unique to Columbia, the foundations of data science are really drawn, stand on these three pillars of strength. At other universities, it's usually drawn from computer science and statistics. And so I think this is something that's quite special at Columbia. The second part of my mission statement is to transform all fields, professions, and sectors through the application of data science. And this really speaks to the full-fledged nature of Columbia University. We've got a journalism school, law school, business school, of course, all the arts and sciences departments, an engineering school, medical center, social work school, you name it, we've got it. I feel my role and my responsibility is to really spread the expertise of data science throughout the university so that disciplines that are sitting on interesting data sets can unlock the mysteries in those data sets through the use of data science. And this is really happening as I speak. I see this in the new recruits
set. All the schools around campus are hiring. The students absolutely get it. They are usually ahead of where the faculty and administrators are. And I'm sure that's true here at UCI. And finally, ensure the responsible use of data to benefit society. And there are really two parts to this as well. To benefit society speaks to the kinds of students and faculty who are attracted to Columbia University. We like to think about tackling grand societal challenges, whether it's energy, climate change, healthcare, social justice. It really speaks to taking the kind of research that we do in the university and having positive societal impact. But part of the mission statement that I really want to emphasize is responsible use. And this really speaks to the fair and ethical use of data. Again, I almost don't have to motivate this now, given the headlines that we have had just this week. And I think it's very important for all the students on campus here, all the students who are interested in data science, but that really means probably everyone in the room and the other room, to be thinking about, as you are doing data science, as you're collecting data, especially about people, as you're analyzing the data, especially if it's about people, to be thinking about these questions of fairness, privacy, ethics, and so on. Okay, so my three-word tagline for the mission statement at Columbia is data for good. And this really pretty much sums it up. Very easy three-word principle to remember. We are, as I mentioned, quite broad. We have over 300 affiliated faculty across 12 different schools. And you can see the breadth of the participation by faculty across campus. We are very loosely structured around themes or centers, working groups. Foundations, I already mentioned, really draws the computer science, statistics, and operations research. We have a cybersecurity center, a center on data, media, and society that has been looking at things like fake news, business and financial analytics center, health analytics, smart cities, and also sort of a sister center on Sense, Collect, and Move, which is more interested at the device level. And we have a computational social science center, which really engages a lot of the social, behavioral, and economic scientists on campus. A computing systems center, which is primarily looking at new computing architectures for data-driven science. So there's a nice intersection there. And then a nascent materials discovery analytics center. How do we discover new materials based on experiments that we can run based on the physics of the materials? We have a master's program that's been ongoing. This past year, our applicants were up by 42%, which is crazy. But it goes to show the demand of data science by the students, and also all of our students get placed, so there's a huge demand also in industry for these students. And many of the students are now thinking about going on to graduate school as well, so not all of them necessarily go to work for industry. This is an example of the kinds of industries that our students go to work for, and it really covers a gamut of sectors. It's not just the IT sector. Of course, being in New York, many of our students go to Wall Street, work in finance, or media companies, and they're large and small companies, startups, and so on. We have a very strong and robust industry affiliates program. These are companies that want to work with the Data Science Institute because of our students, because of our faculty. Sometimes they sponsor research. Sometimes they work with us through our capstone course. I think your undergraduate program has a capstone course, so does our master's program. Basically, it's one term where a data set coming from the industry affiliate comes to a team of students. They work on that data set, working with a mentor in that company, and doing interesting data analysis. So one example is with the Department Department of Environmental Protection, predicting trash hotspots in New York City, and they maybe the result is a little obvious, finding that the population density is the single best predictor of trash complaints. Another completely different example is working with Synergic on legal precedents, and just try to automate some of the work that lawyers do. I point this out because you know, some of our industry affiliates who actually are lawyers have come to us kind of predicting the future of the when lawyers are replaced by bots, and what would the role of a human lawyer be? I mean, this is really playing out some of the kind of how the technology is unfolding. It's quite interesting to think about that for any particular sector. We also are very engaged, as because of how we were started, with the startup community in New York City. A few startups have come out from students and faculty involved in the Data Science Institute. What I wanted to really spend the rest of my time on is to just give you a few snippets of the kind of research that's going on across campus using data science. And I thought I would structure that along the three-part mission statement. And so in terms of advanced state-of-the-art data science, I'm just going to give you one story here just to show that we have some computer science, statistics, and OR faculty who are really trying to advance the field in terms of the research they do in algorithms, in machine learning, and so on. So the one little story I'm going to tell you about is understanding expectation maximization. So how many of you here have heard of maximum likelihood estimation? Okay, excellent. So as you know, this maximum likelihood estimation is a way to estimate the parameters of a distribution based on some number of observations. Like, say I wanted to estimate the, or say I wanted to know what the distribution of the height of all men at UCI are, and I just take the height of all of you and I try to estimate the mean and the variance just based on these observations. Well, the technique of expectation maximization has been used, okay, hit that slide, has been used since the 1970s when it was first invented to estimate the MLE, the maximum likelihood estimation. And it's been used for so many applications, all very successfully, but it's a heuristic. And there were no theoretical guarantees about the algorithm itself or whether it actually produces anything related to the MLE or anything like that. And so the work done by Daniel Chu, a statistics professor and one of the graduate students, showed that EM actually iterates to convert to one of two equivalent global maximizers at linear rate, so there's efficiency of result for all possible initial relations. So in the past, one would not be able to say for all initial relations, but one might be able to say something for this particular initial set of conditions. And moreover, EM actually gives the right answer for what you would be looking for. It's establishing some statistical consistency. Now, this is a, it might not sound like a big result, especially because it's only actually worked for two Gaussians, but the point really is that there are people who are really trying to understand the science of these heuristics that are so commonly used. One of the reasons I'm picking on this example, besides sharing it with you, is to raise the awareness and attention to, of course, the other big elephant in the room, which is DNNs, or deep neural networks. I'm sure all of you have heard of them. And they also, and this is certainly based on my experience being at Microsoft, and we see it everywhere, lots of companies now, where everyone's jumped on the DNN bandwagon, but for good reason, because DNNs have shown to have astounding applications to human-level tasks that we thought were not necessarily breakable, just maybe translation, playing Go. I mean, it's just absolutely amazing that deep learning is producing such scalable, practical results. And why do I say this? Why am I telling you this story in this part of the section of my talk? It's because we still don't actually understand the science of why DNNs are producing such astounding results. And to me, that as a scientist, that's not acceptable. And one reason it's not acceptable is because after a while, we will hit a wall. I mean, usually, this is how science and technology plays out. And then what? And so it's good to understand the scientific principles of why something works so that we can actually continue to build on those understandings for the next, you know, the next turn of the crank, if you will. So that's an outstanding open research agenda for much of the machine learning community today. So now let me talk about some of the applications of data science in other disciplines that is happening on at Columbia's campus. And I'm going to walk through this, each one at a fairly high level. So not surprisingly, one of the applications is in biology and healthcare and more generally. And this one is work done by, you can see, a large collaboration of faculty and other collaborators at Columbia on using the data to combat cancer. And let me just see if I can get that slide or not. Okay. So it used to be the case that and you read this in the medical literature that when you want to understand cancer, you look at the tumor cells. But it turns out that you gain a lot of information if you also look at the microbiome around in the tumor cells of tumor cells. And this is a hot area in biology in general, looking at the microbiome. And so what this group of people did was they looked at all the genetic makeup of the microbiome, and they discovered that the microbiome was actually counteracting the chemotherapy treatment used for pancreatic tumor cell. So this is like, well, that's not good. But they also went further, and they discovered that if you inject the pancreatic cancer tumor cells with an antibiotic, that antibiotic would then counteract the effect of the microbiome's effect, and therefore making effective the chemotherapy treatment. This is two negatives make the positive sort of thing. And they did this all basically through this data-driven method. That's just one example of the kind of work that biologists, especially cancer researchers, have been doing at Columbia and elsewhere. I mean, this is really a hot area. And there's another project that I just gave a DSIC award to that is looking for, at using lots and lots of different kinds of data to do personalized treatment of certain kinds of cancer cells. And I'm not going to tell you that story, but just to say there's a lot going on at Columbia in that area. The next one, popping up many levels, this is a very interesting data set. It's called Observational Health Data Sciences and Informatics, which we pronounce the Odyssey. It has 1 billion patient records representing 400 million unique patients in the world. So it's a federated database covering over 25 countries. 200 researchers are involved in it, involving 80 different databases. Each database, think of as a medical center. So you have a medical center here, there's a database there with all the patient records. That's potentially one of the databases in this. And Columbia is the coordinating center, and many, many people are involved. And this is all observational data. And what they were able to do, and now this is the beautiful visual that you need a little storytelling to understand and appreciate, what they were able to do is to collect all these observations of all these patients, and they looked at, in this particular paper, 3 different diseases, diabetes, hypertension, and depression. And each one of these circles, and I'm second drug, and that's what you, that's the second circle, second ring. And if that still doesn't work, then you get a third drug, and so on and so forth. So I hope you understand how to read these circles. So it turns out that if you collapse all the data sets collected from all the countries and look just at hypertension, what you would see is that 1/4 of the patients in this federated data set are treated uniquely for hypertension. This pops out at you when you look at the data. What that means is if you're in that 1/4 and you have hypertension, I'm your doctor, and you say to me, Jeanette, is there anyone else in the world being treated like me for hypertension? The answer would be no. That's amazing. That alone, I don't know what that means medically, but that is the kind of information that you can glean once you've got all this data in front of you. Another interesting story that one can tell is if you look at this for diabetes, I'm not showing all the circles, if you will, representing all the data sets, but you see most of the, all the others, except for this one, will kind of look like this, where the first line of treatment pretty much works. And so this is the outlier. This is a Japanese medical center. And it turns out that just after having looked at this data, this popped out, and people said, well, what's going on there? It turns out that the Japanese are genetically disposed against this particular drug, this chartreuse or yellowish kind of drug. So the doctors there know, after time, not to give that because it's not going to work. Or you see that it doesn't work and something else has to happen. And so that was also an interesting observation that pops out at you once you look at the data. And of course, the next obvious question I had to the researchers, well, what about the Koreans and the Chinese? Just thinking, you know, maybe there's something in the Asian genetic makeup. And it's not true that the Chinese and Koreans of the data set that they had collected. So there's something specific to the Japanese. I don't know why. Again, this is something that now raises the question of, well, why, and let's go study why. One other thing that I would like to mention about this a lot, I think I'll skip that. Okay.
Did you see anything over there, you know, something that came out in terms of the environment that people were in?
It's a really good question, and I can't. I mean, this data set is, this is what is amazing, and I think the database people will really appreciate this. What is amazing is that this group of people agreed on a standard format for all these electronic health records to be stored in such that you could do these queries. That alone was, I think, a major community coup. Because you know how hard it is for people to agree on a standard format, especially for electronic health records, but they saw the value to doing that conversion such that everyone now has access to. Now, so it's only what's in the EHRs. And that's also varies from data set to data set. It's the tip of the iceberg, obviously, because you like to throw in the environmental information, you like to throw the genomic information, and I have a colleague in the School of Dentistry. He's the dean of the School of Dentistry. He wants to add dental medical records to these electronic health records. And his observation, and this is really not a big insight, is in the world that we have all grown up in, for some weird reason, our mouth is treated completely separate as a separate entity from the rest of our body. So we go to the dentist and we get all the stuff done in our mouth and we go to the doctor for everything else. And there's like no, I don't know, maybe that's Western. There's no rhyme or reason why our mouth should be separated from our body that way. But it is. So his idea was, well, all this dental information we have about people should be part of the health record of people, right? I mean, it only makes sense. And if you actually start looking at correlations, maybe there's stuff going on in your mouth that can tell something about your heart. I don't know, I'm making this up. But without having the data side by side or correlated, you're never going to know. So I think these to me, this is like basic stuff. But when you realize how we have grown up as a culture, it's like, oh my God, of course. Like, it makes a lot of sense, doesn't it?
So, nobody ever has correlated the mouse with the duck.
There probably have been. I actually can't tell you because I don't know. This is not my area of
expertise.
You would think. You would think. Okay. Now for something completely different. So biology, medical, I think it's kind of obvious. There's tons and tons of data. We can do tons and tons of really interesting stuff with it. So this is a professor in history who has amassed the largest collection of declassified documents. So every year the United States releases a set of documents and declassify them, release it to the public. Basically, what he and his colleagues did is he just snarfs all that up every year. He puts it all under one roof. He's got a cool API. He can actually query it and do interesting things with it. And then working with people like David Blind, machine learning people, they've been analyzing the text of various parts of this document, these kinds of documents. So one example is they looked at the cablegrams that were sent between diplomats in the 70s. And they just looked at the metadata and the contents of the cablegrams to see if you can detect interesting historical events just from the text. And what they were able to show is that, in fact, you can, and each of these black dots represents an interesting historical event. Of course, you have to define what interesting means. That's the whole look for the anomaly. And so, for instance, they show that they can detect the what is the evacuation of Saigon or the death of Mao Zedong and so on, just from the cablegrams that are sent between the diplomats. Another whole other area of text analysis came from some work done at the business school, where they wanted to determine if you just look at news articles, you know, kind of munch through all the text of all these news articles, if you can determine any kind of, predict anything about the market. Now, this is not a new idea, because it's not surprising to you that if you read the news, maybe you can predict something about the market. What they wanted to do was they wanted to determine what features were relevant, and also to determine two other things that were new. That's what made this piece of work new. One is looking at emerging markets versus developed countries, and the other is to look at short-term versus long-term effects. So in the past, people have looked at mostly only developed countries and only short-term effects. So what first of all I found is that you only need a few features, sentiment, frequency, and unusualness of word to determine, to do some interesting market prediction. Also, they showed that more market reaction happens through looking at news articles in developed than in emerging markets, and long-term effects were more significant than are high and larger for year ahead, or long-term effects than monthly predictions. So this was now. I think I also hit the next slide. I wanted to show you a little math formula that defines what unusualness is, but you can imagine that it has something to do with the frequency of certain phrases, and when you see a phrase that's not in that sort of very frequent, then that would be unusual. Oh, there it is. I did see this slide. So it's really just a little formula for defining unusual. So now let me turn to the third part of my mission statement, which is data for good. And remember, there were two parts to that, responsible use of data and tackling societal grand challenges. Under responsible use, I'd like to use this five-letter acronym to stand for what I mean. There has already been quite a large community called FATML, and since 2014,
in the New York City Bunker Stark Research Lab that has both machine learning people and social scientists working together on these sorts of issues in AI, machine learning, big data, data science. My sole contribution to this acronym is the S. S standing for safety and security, and that's partly for my own background. I feel it's very important for people who are building systems based on big data, data science, AI, machine learning, that they remember that the systems that they're building, if there are self-driving cars, for instance, had better be safe. Security is always going to be a problem because we know that the bad guys are just as smart as the good guys. So the one story I wanted to share with you is on safety and security. I could have picked any one of those, but I wanted to share you this story because it's very recent work done by my colleagues in the computer science department at Columbia on Deep Explore. How many of you might have heard about this? Okay, so I think you probably, the programming language and formal methods faculty at UCI will be particularly interested in this. But basically, and the other reason is the best paper award that they won for this work was published in the SOSP. So this is like hardcore system conference, not your machine learning MIPS and nice ML sort of conferences. So what they were able to do is, and I want to share you a little detail, especially for the computer scientists and software engineers in the audience, is they were inspired by the idea that we use in software engineering for code coverage. So you want to test all the branches in your code to make sure that you've covered the code. And this is a good example of how if you randomly pick some test variables, some values for the test for the variable, you may very easily never touch this buggy code, because how likely are you going to test on the value x equals 0x and dead b? Right, so this is the whole idea, you really want a code coverage. Now, inspired by that concept of code coverage, now let's look at this DNN that is going to determine that is a red car or a car. Their idea was, what's analogous to code coverage, we have something like neuron coverage. So let's see whether this image, what neurons does that image light up? And what edges are lit up as we're processing this input image through this DNN. So this notion is neuron coverage. And I think that was quite insightful. There's another, let me give you the results and then I'll say a little more about the other software engineering insight that they brought to our DNN testing. So first of all, they efficiently and systematically, so what this Deep Explore tool does, and by the way, you can download it on GitHub, it efficiently and systematically tests DNNs of hundreds of thousands of neurons without labeled data. You only need unlabeled seeds. And going to the bottom line, they found thousands of fatal errors in 15 state-of-the-art DNNs for ImageNet, which is a canonical data set for images of choice. These DNNs are used in the vision systems for self-driving cars. They also showed that outside of completely different application, looking at malware. So this is pretty, what's nice about this is that it systematically tests these DNNs rather than, you know, you have to think of an image that's going to break the DNN. And I'm not sure I hit the next slide. I hit the next slide. Let me give you a hint as to how this works. The other software engineering concept that I need to share with you that they are borrowing from is the notion of differential testing. And this is when you basically have two pieces of code that are supposed to compute the same thing. And so then you can see if there's a difference and use that difference to see whether one code is right versus the other. So the other metaphor, the insight they're having is this notion of differential testing, where you need, for this all to work, you need two different DNNs to basically be doing the same kind of classification. So
So let's say I'm trying to classify images. I have two different DNNs, and then using both DNNs, you can actually, what they actually do is they generate automatically, systematically, input images that are going to deliberately have the two DNNs give you different answers. So one will say it's a car, and the other will say, you know, it's a cat. And these are supposed to be DNNs that are supposed to be doing the same classification. And with that, they were able to generate automatically these images that would break these DNNs. So for instance, in this particular case, this is an image that tells the car to veer to the left, and then just by automatically running this tool, they generate an image that's a little darker, and then the classifier spits out the wrong answer saying, veer to the right, and that's what the accident happens. Okay, so now in terms of tackling skills and challenges, I have two very short stories here. One, I mentioned already this notion of using data for good, for instance, in social justice. This is a work that has been done in a collaboration between the School of Social Work and some NLP people in the computer science department. What they did is they looked at the Twitter communication among a Chicago gang. And this, this Chicago gang talks in a very different language from even the kinds of tweets that you and I perhaps use. They use a lot of emoticons, a lot of symbols. It's not clear what a verb is versus a noun. So they actually have to treat this as a brand new language and do a parts of speech tagging on the elements of the language, and they use the help of the gang members to help them do that parts of speech analysis. And once they were able to do that, then they were able to build a classifier to determine whether a phrase or tweet was showing an emotion of loss versus an emotion of aggression. And the idea is that if I can take a tweet so the idea is something like this. Suppose I'm in the Chicago gang and one of my friends is killed. So I might, through tweeting, express a feeling of sadness and loss in my tweets to my friends. Maybe we should get together and commiserate and be sad together. So that would be perhaps an expression of loss. Or you can imagine a different reaction where we start tweeting with each other and saying, I want revenge, I'm really angry, let's go and kill someone else. And so the idea is that if law enforcement can intervene through understanding that tweets expressing this feeling of aggression, then we can actually prevent a real act of violence. So that was a long story, but it's really coming, driven by our collaboration with the social worker, work researcher. So this is just kind of step one of this longer effort. The next one's completely different again, and I just wanted to share with you that at Columbia University, we have a Earth Institute, and within that Earth Institute, we have probably the premier climate scientists who have amassed lots and lots of climate data from lots of other labs and professional organizations, IPCC data, and so on. And what they have built is basically this open source platform where others can add their data and their tools and their models, machine learning models, data analytic models, so that others can use it. And one thing that one of the climate scientists is a specialist is in oceans. And so this is just an example. This is not generated by their work, but by NASA and JPL. It goes to show that when you have basically 2 petabytes of data being simulated, a simulation of all the ocean currents around the world. And this is tip of the iceberg of what is coming in terms of the IPCC data that's to come is going to be the order of magnitude more data. And testing different areas of Columbia using Twitter data. So one is the architecture school. We have some urban planning people. And they've been just looking at tweets of people in New York City in the parks just to get a sense of what the New York City citizens like or dislike about the parks. And I was saying to him, oh, well, why don't you use some other information, like, you know, with your cell phone or location. He said, you know what, I get such rich information by just the tweets. I don't need all that other stuff. I'm already getting more of this. He was saying, telling me, this is changing the way I am thinking about city design. That to me, well, I didn't say it, he said. The other is a new faculty member coming in the public policy school, School for International Public Policy. She has been looking at tweets of terrorist groups around the world to determine whether we can predict when there might be. This is real stuff. This is impactful, real world stuff. This is not just, you know, things that we might share with each other and what are you eating today? This is, and she has some amazing results. And she had a lot of work to do because they, and all these groups are tweeting in their own language. And so there's a translation needed and all, but it's amazing. So this is just the tip of the iceberg of what we could do. And you know, in some senses, just tweets. You know, what we had other ways of communicating. Yes, question there.
Hi, thanks so much. I'm Matt Beats in the Department of Informatics here. And I wanted to ask you, like, following up a little bit on some of this tweet research, and you mentioned several times the ethical concerns. And like the tweet study that you mentioned, is an ethical minefield because while it's got this sort of good purpose, it's also increasing the surveillance burden among communities of color. It's wading into all of this very contentious space about gangs and police and policing. If there are questions about whether or not this is truly public data, that while the platform is public, that actually recent research is showing that most people tweeting don't actually understand what that means or what the consequences of that are. So informed consent. I wonder if you can just muse a bit about the ethical situation of research using tweets.
Well, let me first of all say that this particular work was driven by the social work faculty member who has worked with the Chicago gang before and has established clearly a trust relationship with the members, and that's how we could even get access to them. And I don't want to say anything wrong, but my guess is that he got the permission of the members to participate. And he works very closely with New York City youth as well in underserved neighborhoods. So this is his bread and butter research. Now, you ask a very good question, and this is very timely, of course, in terms of people who do not realize that their data is public, and that's tweets, and thus can be used. Or when you sign or agree that terms of agreement, that you realize that your tweets can be used for other purposes. This, first of all, I actually did some work a few years ago with my colleagues at Carnegie Mellon and someone who's now at Berkeley on the formal, this is actually his PhD's thesis, was on looking at privacy policies of various companies, Yahoo, Google, Microsoft, so on, and looking at those terms of agreements and coming up with a couple of may not use this data for this purpose, or you may use this data only for this purpose. All these, but the point was this: this notion of use and purpose. This is something that we often forget. It's not just about the data, but it's about what you're going to use it for. And that's where things get kind of tricky, because you, in your the legal contract, you may not anticipate other uses, or there might be language like it's okay to use it for research. You know, what does that mean? But believe me, the different companies have different terms of agreement. So for instance, Yahoo published in their public privacy policy that it says, we will not use the contents of your email for targeted advertising, but we will for spam detection, which makes perfect sense. Whereas if you look at Google's terms of agreement on that, it's silent. And we know that. So it's actually worth reading the fine print. Now, the ethical issues, I think, are only now being raised as a concern. Yes, I signed that privacy thing, but are you, is it ethical for you to use it in the way that you are, even though I signed it? I think this first came up, and I was at Microsoft at the time. If you remember, there was a paper in 2014 co-authored by people from Facebook and Cornell. And does anyone remember this incident? It made the New York Times. It basically showed that it was easy enough for Facebook to manipulate people's emotional state by what they showed you. This was, people didn't like knowing that Facebook could manipulate you that way. I was at Microsoft at the time. It caused a great stir in the academic community because we didn't know that that was really an ethical use of people's data to manipulate us in that way. So within Microsoft, we immediately had this internal discussion about ethical use of data. And where we came, oh, by the way, you should realize that companies are not subject to IRB approval. They don't get federal money, and therefore they are, there's nothing, no such thing as IRBs for companies. Now the tricky thing is this paper was co-authored by Facebook and Cornell, and you'd like to hope that the Cornell side of things actually went through an IRB. That's a whole other story. But for sure, the Facebook people did not have to go through this IRB. So we at Microsoft are saying, even though we do not have to have an internal IRB process, we think the right thing to do is to set one up for ourselves internally. It will demonstrate goodness to our customers that we really care about their data and we really care about their privacy. And so that's what we did. We set up internally an IRB process for privacy and ethics, for ethical use of data. And now that is kind of routine within the company. Moreover, we talked to our colleagues at Facebook and Google and Amazon and so on, and we said, here, look at what we have set up. Maybe you might want to do something similar. So this was really, I like, I'm very proud of this because it was my Microsoft researchers really leading company-wide think on this topic. That is where we are in ethics. The point really is, these are hard questions. These are hard questions. We are only now teasing out the implications of paying attention or not paying attention. And I think the epitome of that is Mark Zuckerberg testifying from the conference. Yes?
So if decisions about research parts are being made based partly on the people who tweet, that's another ethical issue.
Exactly. This, I completely agree. This is one thing I said to my colleague in the architecture school, and he understands that. I think he's just like a kid in a candy store, though.
take some things offline, but there's a code word for those who are in the class, Columbia, for today. we can continue, and I think you had a question, and there's one more question.
Okay, we have a question.
Maybe folks can leave it there.